smashed my face off an outdoor pull-up bar the other day, and it still hurts.
Did you get fucking high and decide to cut your beard again? You idiot.
I wanted to thank you guys for finally naming the BMF, because it's something that I've just been like using the wrong words for a while. And I'm glad that you guys came up with a name for it. You put it like, what, 20 now?
Yeah.
And I'm glad that there's finally like a phrase and a definition.
You got to explain this.
Yeah, so Craig has no idea. I'll let you explain. That's but I just wanted to thank you for finally like coining a phrase.
Man, yeah, yeah. And well, your gratitude for that is the ultimate compliment, because that's a, the BMF is kind of is one of our babies. It's one of the cornerstones of our views on rock, and it kind of like gets tied into all these different ideas about music. But essentially, the quick way to describe the BMF is, it's the point in the song in which all of the production layers, all of the sonic layers of the band are fully activated, and they operate with one thing in common, right? So that could be rhythm, that could be a note, that could be punches, whatever it is. This is not the point in time in the song where, you know, the bassist is ripping, the drummer is ripping, and the guitarist is playing a solo, all of which are separate. This is the moment where all three, or in our case, all three members, but all the members of the band come together, and everything operates as one sound. And that's, to us, like, this is the ultimate wall of sound. This is the ultimate thing that you can combine instruments together and create in the rock world. And that covers everywhere between, you know, 20 hertz to 20 kHz, and that's the full spectrum. Everything is going and everything is fully active. But it's also heavily rooted in the fact that this is not something that happens with lead parts, because part of our belief in the issue with rock that we saw was this accent that rock bands always place on lead parts being the big climactic moment of a rock song. Is like when you have like a guitarist just ripping his guitar solo and he's at the top of his neck, and like, to us, that was just like, that's not the thing that impresses us when we go see a band. The thing that impresses us when we go see a band is when the entire band just fucking locks together and it becomes this wall of sound. So that's what we named the BMF, and we noticed like it's all about the rhythm, and it's all about the rhythm section. And that introduced us to this whole idea. Is like, then you introduce into rock this whole new aspect, which is a much bigger bass, like lots of bass that hip hop adopted really well. And now like, it's like a given, a hip hop production is going to have lots of bass. We never got to the point where like real rock music was represented in a way where it had that much bass. That hasn't happened yet. So that's kind of like where the BMF, and that's like largely where our entire sound came from, was that desire. And we would always listen to Rage Against the Machine and go, holy shit, imagine that riff. You know, imagine that fucking riff if it was produced by a hip hop producer, if that bass was just driving and the tones were just huge. Imagine every aspect of this frequency spectrum was just filled to the ultimate fucking tipping point. That would be the ideal top sounding Rage record to us. So that's kind of like what we spent a bunch of time envisioning and then trying to create through our own sound. But that's BMF.
So with that said, I think I know what BMF means.
Yeah.
But what does it stand for?
It stands for big motherfuckerness.
Yeah, dude. Fuck yeah. That's what I thought. Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Big motherfuckerness.
It's funny too, because like that was something I over the past like few years with newer rock coming out and stuff, I was like noticing this pattern of like, there's not that many guitar solos anymore.
Yeah.
But there is a pattern now of like, these songs have these like moments in them where the guitar solo might usually be, like typically in a song. There's just these like badass moments and songs. And then that was something that I was bringing. It's like the guitar player in my band is a ripping guitar player, and he loves solos. And I was like, dude, I was like, I think that like solos are out. And like, it's been something that we've been writing songs a lot now where it's like, okay, cool. We're at like the middle section of the song. And it's like, what are we doing here to make it better than the fucking last one?
Yeah.
That's not just like, all right, let's, I guess it's a guitar solo now that we'll do in this middle section.
Yeah, it's almost like a cop out to do, to just be like, all right, well, guitar solo now.
The thing is that this is a trend that I've noticed a lot in other genres as well, particularly in funk music. I've noticed that funk guitarists are very, like, their lead parts are very rhythm driven. And like, it's like, for example, like the Michael Jackson stuff is a good example of funk guitar playing that sounds like lead parts, but they're all rhythm parts, you know, like all those lead guitar parts in Thriller are all they just drive the rhythm. And I noticed that, like, even when you watch the interviews of these guitarists, they'll talk about their technique and they'll mention this. They'll mention the fact that what they're doing is just applying the practice of playing their guitar as though it's a lead part, but playing a rhythm part and that contributing to groove, and then letting the groove be the bigger voice that is communicating the musical piece that you're hearing. And so that was very insightful for me, because I just listened to like a shit ton of Wolfpack, and
fuck yeah, those holy shit,
dude, that's like, see, like that is groove. Like Corey Wong is an incredible lead guitar player, but he's even better of a rhythm player, and he's such a good rhythm player that you can't even replicate his rhythm parts. That's how good they are. But
dude, you like the band, right? You're the band guy.
No, I don't have a history with the band. No, I don't.
Oh, dude, you gotta listen to the band.
I'll check it out.
You're gonna love that shit. But yeah, Wolfpack are fucking amazing.
Yeah, man, dude, like that. They're live at Madison Square Garden show just changed my life.
Oh fuck yeah! I gave that. We do You Should Jam all the time for this show, and I gave that album to Caleb, and it is still, it's got to be high on the list.
It's been my number one for like the whole
number
like,
one baby
months.
Yeah, no,
number
it,
one
it honestly incredible. It honestly is that good. And take this in, one of the best parts about their entire product, it's all DIY. It's all recorded at home, all
no label,
all mixed by Jack Stratton, and it's all like, dude, that's, to me, that's the best. It's the fucking best.